Our first song this morning will be number 742, and we will be utilizing the songbooks for this one. Number 742. When we all have that, let's sing. When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God
special prayer requests and things of that nature. In spite of all that, besides all of that, it's good to welcome back our beloved Joyce Niederman back from her world travels. She's writing a book about all of these travels, I'm sure, that she's going to share with us. I don't know, is this thing on really? Can you hear me? I can't hear me. It's not on. My voice is on, thank goodness. Let me see. It says it's on. Anyway, we'll get it fixed because my voice is only going to be good for so long. Anyway, another holiday weekend for us, Memorial Day weekend. Memorial Day is in honor of me. No, it's not. It's in honor of those who served in the military. I mean, memorials are, you know, we can be overcome by memorials, but for those who serve, those who sacrificed for our country, this day is in honor of you. And if we have any here that are serving and have sacrificed, why don't you stand for us? Anyone who has served in the military or is serving. I believe Jim Roberts served. Jim Roberts served, yes. Yes, give my hand, Yes. If you have anyone that served at the Memorial Day potluck last week, please stand. Please stand. Give them a hand. If you served last week, you see what I mean? Service. If there's anyone who if there's anyone who served anyone this week, please stand. Anyone who served anyone, nobody, come on, somebody served somebody. Thank you very much. Please stand. We should be servants. If nothing else, that's who we should be. And we are to be recognized for our servanthood. And so the announcements that I have only, I don't see any announcements. One announcement. I see, let us pray. Boom. Okay. CEO, yes. CEO, let Ginger know if you plan to attend, would like to attend the CEO Christians Eating Out. Sounds like an exclusive club where you need, you know, there's membership dues and stuff like that, but it actually isn't. You know, but see Ginger about it, and she will put your name on the list. Looks like it's going to be at the Olive Garden right here in Santa Maria. Let her know. Prayers for Freddie. Freddie, I don't know Freddie's last name, but we know her as Freddie, Paul's friend, who sent a message this morning that she had to take her mother to the hospital. Don't know much about what's going on, but just keep her in prayer. And if that is all, then as we enter into this time of worship to God, let all that we say and do be directed towards God and for God, knowing that everything that we have comes from God. And so let us pray. Kind and merciful Heavenly Father, thanking you always for the things that you have provided for us, the things that you have corrected in our lives, the things that you have made straight in our lives, for the things that you do, that Father, that we just don't even know about. We come this morning asking for forgiveness of sins, laying them at your feet with heartfelt confession of repentance, Father, so that we will not stray from your ways, Father, but will always adhere to your will, thanking you for forgiveness in Christ, our Savior. And with that in mind, Father, we come to praise you. We come to worship you. We come to show you that you are the love of our lives, Father. As much as you have loved us, we can never repay you. But please accept our worship this morning. Be with us during this time, Father, and those who are away and struggling spiritually, Father, those who do not feel the connectedness, Father, let this be a time of restoration for them. Help us to help each other. Help us to lean on you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say amen. Amen.
The next song this morning, way number 452. Once again, that's number 452. And if you're able, could we all stand for this song, please? 452.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages, let
shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior.
After the singing of this song, we'll be led in communion and in the contribution prayer.
My sight and drops of the reef can Mary pay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. Tis all that I can do.
I was reading in one of the pamphlets that we received here, I think the Action, when it's a little magazine pamphlet type reading that was sent out. This was a while back, and it was sharing about older sister in Christ, I'm not sure what her age is, that was in Afghanistan, and that's where she'd been for a while, I guess, and she got really close with the Christians there, the church there, and that was before we pulled out of Afghanistan, so there was some freedom, or a lot more freedom than there is now again, but, and so it was around that time, and the lady didn't want to leave, and they were telling her to leave. The other Christians, the government, all those involved were trying to make sure nothing would happen to her. And she didn't want to leave. She kept, and she says that, it says that in the story that she said that she'd rather stay there and help those brothers and sisters, and that she wanted to be there to continue helping them to grow and to keep faithful. And they were saying, these were now faithful Christians, they had turned from Muslim to Islam to Christianity. And they said, no, you've got to leave. We want you to be saved, because we don't know what's going to happen, because they're coming in. They already knew the Taliban was going to be coming in. So it was back and forth, and it just finally, she did get the help to get out, and they left. But I was thinking of that, how some have done, and it reminds me, but more the importance of what Jesus did. But there are Christians that do that, that think of others, that think enough that they're not concerned enough to stop what they're doing that they know is important in their heart and their spiritual life, and make it easier by just not being there. And you're safe, and we know, we see that when we read the scriptures that the disciples and others that were just followers that saw what Jesus did, they were saying the same thing to him. No, you can't go, Paul and the other disciples. And no, we'll fight for this. You know, we'll fight for your protection. In other words. That's what I understood by some of the scriptures in there. And he said, no, I got to go. And why? Because I got to send the comforter. God's got to send the comforter back to be with you. That was the plan. If not, and to be die, but be resurrected and ascend to heaven. All those things have to be. So all this remind me of the remembrance of that we're doing now is that he did it, and we know why. The forgiveness of our sins, and all people that come to him will be forgiven. And also for those things also, so we can receive the Spirit that helps us now as we partake, as we walk and our Christian life. It convicts us, it comforts us, all those things. And so there's much more than just a thought of something that happened a long time ago. It's still working now. And if we let it, let us give thanks for the body and the blood. Heavenly Father, we constantly are reminded, especially through your word, and many times even by your creation, of your goodness, of the plan you have for everything, how you set things in motion and continue to hold things together. And you know, we know, there'll be much suffering in the time that we're all here in this earth, because it is a physical. But we're so thankful, Father, you gave your spirit, you sent it to be able to help us when many times we're not able to do it. But just to have that constant reminder that you're with us always. And at this time that you're with us, Father, we ask your blessing on each one of us, all Christians that are partaking this morning, that we remember each one of us. And sometimes we think that we're better than we are, Father, that we all have sinned and they all need forgiveness. We pray that because of that truth, we do this remembrance of the price of that event of your son hanging on the cross and giving all for us. And we thank you. Be with us now, Father. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you again for your son, your sacrifice, and giving his blood for our sins, Father. Help each one of us again as we reflect and when we examine ourselves, knowing that there was no other way. No matter what reasons or excuses the world makes, we still know that because of sin, you had to send your son and he had to die. That thanks to you, Father, that he is alive and he's with you and that we can be with you. So help us, Father, to be thankful and remember all good things that come from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, again, we'd like to have a prayer for the offering and again for all the blessings that God the Father has given to us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for taking care of us in all things. Materially, the way you've given us opportunities to work, to learn either a trade or whatever it is that we need to have employment. That you give us physical strength to be able to do it and our health. We know there's many that are not capable. And you've set that in motion also, that we as your church could help in those needs that are out there, Father. And we ask you to bless us in that work, but also, and more importantly, that we spread your word, Father, your love through the actions, through your word, and that the money that we collect here and in other congregations could be always taken care of in a way that and spread out and used in the way that would be the most efficient and blessing according to your will, Father. So we thank you that we do have this opportunity, each one, as we purpose in our heart, Father. With joy, we pray that we give. We ask these things through Jesus. Amen.
Are there any children in attendance today that are going to be attending Sunday school, be dismissed at this time? Our song before the scripture reading and sermon this morning will be number 869. Once again, that's number 869. We'll be singing verses 1, 2, and 4. And then if you're utilizing a songbook this morning and would like to mark the song of invitation, it's number 509. Once again, that's number 509. You could all stay with me for this song and remain standing afterwards for the reading of our scripture. That's it. Come we that love the Lord and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, Zion, the beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of
Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion, we're marching upward to Zion, Zion, the beautiful city of God.
You all look so lovely out there. You know, I just want to give you a big hug myself. I'm going to stand right here. This is my hug to you. But I'm going to give you the opportunity to hug each other right now. So take a few seconds to just reach across the aisle, you know, people behind you, front to back, hug each other just real quick. We are going to consider some passages this morning from the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter number 40, and the verses that we're going to look at this morning are verses 27 through 31. 27 through 31. New American Standard Version 1995. If you have it, say amen. Amen. The Bible reads, "Why do you say, O Jacob, and assert, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and the justice due me escapes the notice of my God?" Why do you say that? He says, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth," everybody say this with me, "does not become weary or tired." Thank you. His understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, he increases power. Though youths, young people, like all of you, may grow weary and tired, and vigorous men like Darren, vigorous young men, may stumble badly. I'm talking about the young part and the vigorous part. Yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. And they will walk and not become weary. Shall we pray? Father, your word is such a wonderful blessing to us, in that it tells us about your character, Father. It tells us about your desires for us. At this time, We pause, Father, to hear a portion of your word, to consider the precepts and pericopes and the exegetical information in your text, Father. We pray that it speaks to our hearts, Father. Speaks to our conditions, Father, that we do not turn a blind eye or a deaf ear to what the word is telling us or trying to say to us. Bless us during this time. Grab us by the insides and twist us up, turn us upside down, and make us all straight and better. In Jesus' name we do pray. Let us all say amen. Kindly be seated. I may have preached a sermon on this subject or with these passages or from these passages at some point, at some time. If you've been here sitting on my right or sitting on my left, you may have heard me speak from the text of Isaiah chapter 40, because it's a very powerful text, you know, that it sounds good. Those that wait on the Lord will get eagle's wings. They will run and not get weary. Walk. It sounds good. It's a very motivating contemplation. And it's filled with a lot of things that will happen. When we see the words will in text, as in this case, he says, yet those, in verse number 31, who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. It doesn't say might gain new strength. It says you will gain new strength. He says you will mount up with wings like eagles, and you will run and not get tired, and will walk and not become weary. Will is a very defining and powerful and definite word. When something will happen, it's prophetic as well, and that there is no question as to whether it will come to fruition. It's just a matter of when. But it requires something from us. He said, this is a requirement. Yet those who what? I can't hear you. Those who what? Those who what?
Wait.
Those who wait for the Lord. So that there's a prerequisite condition. Something has to happen. You do something, and then this is going to happen. And it's this thing called waiting that I want us to consider, because waiting is something that challenges all of us. You cannot live in this life and not experience the struggles or the joys of waiting. And they are just that. Waiting is either a struggle or it's a joy. I'm going to say it because it came to my mind. Just like you listening to me this morning might be a struggle or it might be a joy. Nobody laugh at me. That's my own joke then for myself. Okay. Amen, Walls. I laugh at it. We wait on things. We again, it is inescapable to understand what it is to wait. Now, waiting has different definitions for different types of waiting. But the waiting that I want us to consider this morning is the waiting that leads to blessings. Waiting that leads to blessings. Not waitings that lead to you having your way, but waiting that leads to the blessings that God wants to provide for, that God wants to reveal to us. There's the waiting that we wait on our expectations, and then there's waiting on God's expectations. Are you with me? consider this. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. Because sometimes waiting is painful. Sometimes it's frustrating. You know, I'm waiting on my check to come in the mail. You know what I mean? I'm waiting on, you know, for them to bring my food to my table at the restaurant, and I'm hungry. I'm waiting in line to get gas in my car so that I can get back on the road. Consider this. You know, there was a time when, you know, we're traveling, and you may have experienced this, and you're traveling along, and all of a sudden traffic comes to a stop, right? And if you have navigation, your navigation sets you on this course, and your navigation says, you know, take this route, and you've done everything that the navigation told you to do, and yet unexpectedly traffic stops. And when that happens, we have to wait. But then something happens. If we grow tired of waiting or are impatient of waiting, then we start talking to the computer, to the navigation, said, isn't there an alternate route? Isn't there a better way, a quicker way, a faster way of us getting to where we want to go? And the answer might come back, yes, there's an alternate route. But this alternate route may take you longer. It may take you through some hills and valleys and places that, you know, and there's no guarantee that this alternate route, you may not come across a sudden stop as well. So the message comes back and says, stay on, you are on the best route. Stay on that route. The best course, stay on it. Don't deviate from it. And so what we have to consider sometimes with God, because we enter into these times when we're traveling in this Christian walk, and we have to wait on God in order for us to see His blessing. And that waiting can be painful. It can be a painful thing for us to do. And we want to take matters into our own hands and to rid ourselves of this problem that we have. And God will say, stay on that route. This is the best course. And He has a reason for doing that. Oh, yes, He does. He has a reason. First of all, God knows best. Isn't that right? Amen. I like it when the church talk back to me. I know it's difficult. I like it when they talk back to me. You know, God knows best. Amen. God, who knows better than God? Isn't that right? He knows what's best for our situation. Even though it might seem painful or uncomfortable or not something that we are in agreement with, God knows best. Isn't that right? He knows what's best, because at the end of it, When we stick to the plan, we're going to see the blessing at the end of it. You may not see it right now, but know that there's going to be a blessing at the end of it, because He says, I will do some things. Isn't that right? And when God says, I will, consider it done. Consider it done. I want us to look at this text in the book of Isaiah for a couple of reasons. One, things in our lives don't always happen how we want them to happen, when we want them to happen. We encounter some uncomfortable situations, some times where we just, you know, want to take matters into our own hands. And that's something that, you know, we struggle with. You all, I get no amens on that. So then, you know, the silence in and of itself is my amen. We can struggle with things like that inwardly, in silence, because we want to take things into our own hands. We don't want to listen to the voice of God, the spirit of that's at work within us. We don't want to do that. And so God gives us an example. Let's do this. I need to read it. I need to give you some New Testament command. In Galatians, if you have your Bible, this is not up here. Galatians chapter 6 and verse number 9. Go to Galatians chapter 6, verse number 9. The Bible says, let us not lose heart in doing good. Well, what is doing good? The will of God. Isn't that right? He says, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. So there's this thing that's going to happen. These words are in here for a reason. They're not just happenstance or if you grow weary, you will grow weary. It's not a question of if, but you will grow weary. So how do we look at Old Testament examples for our learning? And that's what we're going to do this morning. The book of Isaiah, in and of itself, can be viewed in terms of its similarities as a miniature version of the Bible. The Bible contains how many books? 66. Well, I heard some thank you, praise. 66 books. The book of Isaiah contains 66 chapters. The Bible is divided into an Old Testament and a New Testament. Isn't that right? Isaiah can be divided in twos as well. In two dynamic sections, I dare say. Chapters 1 through 39 gives us a depiction of God's judgment on man. And in chapters 40 through 66, tells us of his redemption. It shows us a judgmental God in 1 through 39. And in 40 through 66, it shows us, reveals to us through the book of Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, that he is a redemptive God. A God who understands your discomfort and understands your situation. And not only understands it, he is the one that puts you in it, in your situation, when you look at it that way, as a result of your actions. And because of that, even in spite of that, he still has enough love to comfort us and care for us. Am I right? In chapters 1 through 39, we see that God is a God of righteousness. And because of his righteousness, he judges the unrighteous. Isaiah was sent to tell Judah that judgment was coming because of their disobedience to God. But in chapter 40, Isaiah also delivered the message of restoration, a message of restoration to those who were the remnant, those who were the survivors of the Babylonian captivity. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 1 says it this way. He says, comfort, oh, comfort my people, says your God. Speak kindly to Jerusalem and call out to her that her warfare has ended, that her iniquity has been removed, that she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. You see, he pivots from judgment to a God of comfort. But there's a caveat here, is that while you are comforted, you will be in captivity for a while. It's going to be uncomfortable. And you must wait for that time to be comforted. You got to wait. From these passages of scripture, we can see that God has a blessing for Judah. He has a blessing for them. And that God will bless those who wait. Waiting implies a few things. That change is coming. Oh, we wait for change. We don't wait for nothing. We wait for change. Change is coming. That my circumstances are going to change. That my situation is going to change. That my welfare is going to change, that the scope of my enemies is going to change. that relief is coming. That's what waiting is all about. Why wait, man, if nothing's going to change? Keep stepping. Isn't that right? So then, if indeed we have forgiveness of our unrighteous behaviors, if God, if you really have forgiven us, then the question is simply this: why is it that we don't feel the comfort from the unchanged circumstances? If indeed we have forgiveness of sin, why is it? This is the question that we ask God. You know, are you with me, God? And if you're with me, why am I still struggling? Why am I still being pressed on? Why is the knee still on the back of my neck? Why is this still a struggle and that still a struggle? Why are my children still disobedient? Why are my finances, you know, people, the bank is taking my money, the people, the folks repossess my car? Why is my spouse, you know, still the same way that they are? And he says, wait. You gotta wait. Which simply means don't do things in accordance to how you feel right now. Do things in accordance to what I'm asking or demanding that you do. And when you do, you're going to be blessed. Isn't that right? So I want us to look at this waiting from this point. Overcoming struggles by learning to wait. Say that with me. Overcoming struggles by learning to wait. Yes. Lessons are learned when limitations impose themselves upon your situations. Yes, we learn lessons from limitations when they oppose themselves on our situations. Isn't that right? Oh, and it's motivating, if nothing else. If you don't have food in your refrigerator or in your oven or in your cabinet, is going to teach you something, either to avoid being in that situation. You learn something. When we have, let's just stick with it. I'm not going to belabor this because I got a lot to say. Okay? We learn lessons and limitations that we miss when liberties are in place. In other words, when you can have it your way, whenever you want, whenever how you want, there's nothing to learn. You know, I was telling them this morning, this is a problem that we have with our younger generation today, is that we, as parents, and we're the ones to blame, not the kids. We've given them whatever they want, whenever they want. You know, it's just the way that it is. I see you looking at you, it's right. He's saying, dude, is that really right, Mama? This is what we do. We give our children everything they want. All they have to do is ask. They don't have to work for it sometimes. Just everyone else has got it. How come I can't have it? And the parents say, okay, you got it. You know, and we create these situations, okay? While liberties represent freedom and are welcomed, our limitations usher in boundaries that are uncomfortable but necessary for growth and development. So how did they respond to Isaiah's encouragement, to his encouraging word? Huh? What was their response? They complained. Oh, they complained. In verse number 27, he says, why do you say, O Jacob, and assert, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and the justice due me escapes the notice of my God? They had two issues. You either are not, you're ignoring me, there's something wrong. You know, and I'm not going to, let's move on, because I got a lot to say. My plight is hidden from God. That's the first one. And one is my case is being ignored by God, is fading out of his view, fading, and he is blind to my situation. Now remember, they're in captivity, they're hurt,
Right? So he's saying, if God is really a God of forgiveness, and if he really wants, then why has my situation not changed? We feel the same way at times, do we not? That God does not care, that he has not turned a blind eye to our situation. Some of us suffer in silence, always questioning, how long must I wait? What must I do? A closer examination of verse 27 is going to reveal a few things and allow us to understand the nature of their question. Isaiah addresses the people as, he calls them, O Jacob, and he calls them Israel. Now, if you're a student of the Bible, you know that they are the same thing, same reference. Jacob and Israel, he's referring to the same group of people. But you might say, why is he using these two different names? Well, let's give you a little history and then we'll brief in that Jacob in Genesis chapter 32 was one who wrestled with a man. I'm going to say an angel of God, and he struggled with God, with that angel, because he wanted that angel or that man's blessing. And I say it was an angel because of this, an angel of God. He struggled and fought with it because he wanted to give him his blessing. And they fought and struggled and fought and struggled and fought and struggled, and to the point to where the angel finally said, this is why I say it was an angel, is that he touched him on his hip, bam, put him out of socket. Now, I don't know if a man can just touch somebody if you got that kind of power. Paul might have that kind of power. I don't know. Who else? You know, but it ended the struggle. And he says, well, you're not going to go until you bless me. Then the issue of a name came up. He said, your name is no longer going to be Jacob. Your name is going to be Israel. Because you battled with God and with man, and you survived. Okay? Some translations say that you are now a prince. But the issue is that we see two different personalities here. Two different positions here. Jacob was one who struggled with God, was one who was in conflict with God. Israel, who was one who was in covenant with God. Jacob, conflict. Israel, covenant with God. So we see two different personalities. It's like being a double-minded person. You see, they had a struggle with God in that they worshipped other idols and worshipped other gods, didn't do what God, you know, he in fact, that was their problem. Idolatry and a few other things as well. So you see, when we look at, you know, the nature of Jacob, or the character of Jacob and the character of Israel, we can understand a little better why he uses these two names. One who is in conflict on one hand, and the other one who is in covenant with God. And because you are in conflict, God's got a problem with you. Judgment is coming, but because you're in covenant, God still loves you. You see that? Okay. So, we are in covenant with God as Israel, but in conflict with God as Jacob. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and 14, he says, "And my people who are called by my name, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal their life." You see, there's a condition, some prerequisite conditions that we have to follow. And I'm going to go through this. I got a few more. Bear with me. The reality is that problems that are severe or in abundance, they oftentimes create doubt. When you have something that's really pressing on you, you know, be it a health issue, a financial issue, a relationship issue, whatever it is, it can create doubt because there seems to be no relief. Or, as in their case, they had that. And they had them in abundance.
You know, there were a lot of problems that they had. So many that when you have that many problems, it can cause you not to see God. Isn't that right? You can question God's fidelity, like they did. They questioned God's fidelity. But the irony is that while they questioned God's fidelity, they were living in infidelity. Hello. You can question God's fidelity if you are not living in infidelity, but if you are living in infidelity, it's hard to question God's fidelity. It's like having an affair with Satan and expecting God to pay the rent. Well, it just God doesn't roll like that. He just doesn't. So oftentimes our issue with God is rooted in our ignorance of God. Because we don't really know God. We don't really understand God. God is this imaginary figure that can't be reached. He's out there somewhere in the stratosphere instead of sitting right next to you in the pews right now, riding with you in your cars, on your jobs with you, going on vacations with you. God is not there until we need him. Then we look towards him, you know, and that's how we treat God, to pay our rent sometimes. Isn't that right? No amens on that one. Thank you. Because that's not us. That's not how we do it. In verse number 28, this text says, "Do you not know? Have you not heard?" This is Isaiah's response. "The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is inscrutable." When we don't know God, we need some Isaiah to tell us who God is. We need someone like Ben on Thursday nights to tell him who God is at the men's Bible. We need some Rosellas, you know, on Thursday mornings to tell people who God is. We need some brothers like Alfred to stand up and tell people who God is. We need some people to let people to know that God is everlasting. Oh yes, God is everlasting. God is to time. God is, he was, he will always be. He's not limited to time. That God is the creator of all things, which means he's not limited to space. God is God all powerful. He's all powerful. God is omnipotent, all powerful. That God is a God without time. Amen. That God is omniscient. He knows everything. He doesn't, it's not that we, he doesn't hear our prayers. No, and I'm going to just kind of go through this because, you know, I got a lot to say. We need to start learning to do this. We need to start looking and listening and watching for how God answers our prayers instead of looking and learning and watching and listening for the prayer, for the answer that we want. Because God answers the prayer, but just not always how you want it to be answered. He said to them, wait. You got to wait. And some things are going to happen. Judgment has already happened, but now you got to deal with the issues, the fallout from your infidelity, and now you've got to wait. And you're going to see, realize all these things that I said are going to happen. So, in verse number 29, he says, he gives strength to the weary. And to him who lacks might, he increases power. He gives strength because he's all powerful. And he's got the power to give. If you want some power, go to God. Don't come to me. Don't come to, you know, your neighbor. They're not going to be able to give you the power that God can give you. And the power that we're talking about is the power to endure. The power that says wait. The power that says everything's going to be all right. The power says don't listen to the naysayers. Like Job had to do. Don't listen to the naysayers. You know, the people that are telling you to curse God and die, which was his, oh my goodness. Don't listen. God can give you that kind of power. And verse number 30, he even speaks to those who are strong, like all of you young men out there and young women. He says youths, Y-O-U-T-H-S, doesn't say young men or women. It's all of you all, because you're so young, like me. He says, you're going to get weary and grow tired. And the vigorous men, you know, like you know, our brother Jim Roberts, who just, you know, Jim Roberts, I'm putting you out in the web atmosphere. Our brother Jim Roberts, he is a worker bee. He just is. Ever since I've set foot into this church, if anything was being needed done, and I know that's bad grammar, but I just said it. Jim Roberts was right in the middle of it. He did things that, you know, when he stopped doing stuff, I noticed. Because they weren't getting done. And guess what now has to happen? I go around and I'm following Jim Roberts in his shadow where he, you know, locking up doors, and turning off lights, and turning off this and doing all that. Things like that. You know, but we're going to get tired, even the vigorous ones. He says in verse number 31, and this is my last slide, and I'm just going to, because this is good. This is good. Maybe not for the reason that you think, but watch this. He says, yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. Oh, I love that. You don't quite understand it, so you don't know how to say amen and to praise that passage right now. Get this in your spirit. He says, those that wait. Now, the Hebrew word for wait in this text is a word called kaba. Kaba. And this word entails more than just waiting patiently or waiting for an outcome. This word means to tie yourself together with something, to bind yourself up with something. In other words, those who wait on the Lord, it means to bind yourself, tie yourself up to God. Tie yourself up to His will and His strength. Depend on Him. Bind yourself together with Him. And when you do that, what's going to happen? You're going to gain new strength. You're going to gain new strength. So if you want some new strength, bind yourself up with the Lord. If you want, it says they will mount up with wings like eagles. If you want eagles' wings, wait on the Lord. Bind yourself up with Him. Now, eagles' wings, you know, this gives us a picture of they will grow eagles' wings. You don't have them right now. But when you gain, when God gives you that strength, it's going to be like you're going to have eagles' wings. And you'll be able to soar, spread those wings out, and let the air get underneath those wings, and you'll just go higher and higher and higher. That's some power. That's something to get excited about. He says they will run and not get tired. Bind yourself with God. Learn how to wait in His power and His strength. In spite of what everything else is saying in your present condition. You know, and you will run and not get tired. Because without God, you're going to run and get tired. Oh, you're going to run and get tired, and some stuff going to come out your mouth. So things, you're going to go some places, you're going to do some things, you know, that you should not do. You know, but when you wait on the Lord, when you bind yourself up with Him, you'll be blessed. Isn't that right? He says, and they will walk and not become weary. I'm done with that one. He says, so when we come up with God, when we bind ourselves together with God, we are bound to our blessings. That ought to make you excited. You're not going to get them if you don't bind yourself to God. You won't receive those blessings. We just read this morning in 1 Samuel, Saul, who was pronounced king, anointed king, was told to go to Gilgal and wait 7 days. 7 days. He went there because Samuel was going to come and bless him. And before he went into war, he went down and he waited 7 days, but he grew impatient because he looked at his surroundings and the armies that were gathering in front. He looked at his circumstances and he grew weary. And what did he do? He took matters into his own hands and did what he was not supposed to do. He went outside of the limitations. Oh, he had liberty to do it. God will give you the liberty to do whatever you want. But is doing whatever you want within that liberty, is it within his limitations? That's the question. Limitations are there for a reason. And God has them. Step outside of those limitations and you won't be blessed. What happened to Saul? God was not happy. He said, wasn't I going to make you, if you had been obedient and did what I asked you to do, you would have been king forever. But now, you're no longer going to be king. I've chosen someone else to replace you. God had a blessing for him. Number two, we look for how, when we come out with God, we look for how God answers prayers instead of only what we ask for. I talked about that. Number three, when we come out with God, when we bind ourselves with God, we walk with God all the time. It becomes who we are. It becomes who we are. Let it become who you are. Bind yourself to the Lord. Bind yourself to his will. And watch and see how he blesses your life. You want to be comforted? You want to experience the fullness of God and dwell in his place, places of comfort and peace? Bind yourself to him. That's the message that Isaiah gave to them. At least this is what I'm extracting out of these passages. And I think it's a very good and practical lesson for us. We want to do things ourselves. We get tired. We're uncomfortable. We begin to question God as they did. We ask, you know, but God just made it plain. You want me to demonstrate some fidelity to you, but you've demonstrated infidelity towards me. Are we committed to God? Do we see God for who he is? That's what Isaiah, he is everlasting. He's the creator. He is all. God is not bound by the things that we are bound. So the message is this, how this should speak to your spirit, is how long are you willing to wait? How long are you willing to wait for God to speak to your situation? Because he will. There's no question about it. He will. And when he does, will you accept the answer? You are on the best course. You want to deviate, you are on the best course. And it's a difficult, it could be a bitter pill to swallow, but this is God's message. Stay on the best course. Stay on the right road. And you will receive and experience his blessings. Amen. That's my message. I pray that you make this a personal message. Apply it to your lives. And not only will you be applying it to your life, but when others see how you live and how you, who you depend on and how you, what power that you draw from in your bad season, you will be a blessing to them as well. Oh, you will bless them. You see how God blesses. He uses us. Let the Lord use you. Let the Lord use you. And you will be blessed. My scripture invitation is Psalms 42. Verse number 11. It says, why are you in despair, O my soul? And why have you become disturbed within me? He's talking to himself. Hope in God, and I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. Depend on God. Isn't that right? Depend on God for those things that we struggle with. Bind ourselves to him, and he will bless you. We're going to sing our song of invitation. If you need prayers for encouragement, now's the time to come. Let us know. You don't have to let us know all the details, but just that you request prayers. There's power in prayer. And I believe that a lot of the stuff that's happening, I'm just going to say this, myself included, things that are happening in our lives is because we're not praying enough. We're not praying enough. We don't pray enough as a congregation. We don't pray enough outside of this building. We just don't pray enough. And the reason we don't pray enough is because we don't see God as an everlasting God. We don't see Him as a creator. We don't see Him as a God who can provide relief. That He is a God who says, I will do something. I will. So, that's something that we can be prayerful about. That we can pray more. Let us pray more for each other. If you haven't put on Christ in baptism, if you want to receive that Holy Spirit that our brother Alfred talked about during communion, we're going to invite you to come. God wants to bless you, you know, and He will, but He requires you to come. We're going to stand and sing our song of invitation. You're standing. All you got to do is step out into the aisles at that point and come forward. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, how He left His home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with
path and direction, the right words, as we interact with the world. Lord, we pray for our governing peoples that they will look more towards You and less towards themselves. Because frankly, it's not helping right now. We ask that You protect our children, for they cannot protect themselves. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Jesus.